Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's Indians D&D session. Today, Dr. Reema will be presenting a case, and the case would be discussed by a recent psychiatry at NIMHANS. Welcome, all of you, once again. Now, Dr. Ajendra, do you want to tell anything before we start?
So we can have a presentation for 25 minutes, then for a discussion for 20 minutes. So in this case, we can focus on how different is taking or making a diagnosis in children compared to adults. This can be our focus for today.
Very good afternoon to one and all. Mr. X, 15-year-old male, student of class 9, belonging to middle socioeconomic status, with mother as the informant, the history is reliable and adequate. With chief complaints of repetitive unwanted thoughts, repetitive counting, tapping, and to and fro actions since 3 years. The precipitating factor was an incident at hostel in which the patient was ill-treated by his roommates. The onset was insidious and the course is continuous. History of presenting illness. The child was apparently asymptomatic till class 6, was attending a school in his hometown. For further education, the child was sent to a hostel. In class 7, the timings of his school were from morning 7 till 5 in the evening. During this phase, the child reports he was teased very often by his roommates with the names of Brahmananda, which had created a distress for the child. As per the account of the child, an incident happened one day in which the child was ill-treated by his roommates, who were 5 in number. They made fun of the child in odd manner by making sarcastic remarks, spoke foul language, forced him to eat chicken, which he was uncomfortable to do. After the event, the child reports to have discomfort on seeing the stuff which were used by his roommates, like blanket, bucket, mug, clothes, food, and etc. The child says that every time he saw any belonging of his roommates, he would get a thought that something bad was going to happen to him, and he was unable to control his thought, which occurred repetitively, and it made him very uneasy and worried. From then on, he started to remember the names of the people who were good to him and events where good things happened to him. By this, he got some relief from disturbing thoughts which came to his mind continuously. Gradually, the child reports that to get rid of these thoughts in his mind, he started to avoid the things having number 7 in it, like the dates of a month, like 7, 17, 27. On active questioning, he reports the incident happened in class 7, and so as to forget about it, he started to avoid number 7. The child further reports he would not eat on the dates of the month having number 7 in it. Further to this, he even could not utter number 7. In his conversation, he would speak about the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10, leaving the number 7. On questioning, reports the incidents which took place made him do such acts. The child reports he has thoughts that something embarrassing might happen. To get rid of such thoughts, he would repeatedly remember the people, the year, which were found are good memories for him in an odd number fashion of 1, 3, 5, 9, and 11. To do any task like eating, he will count in a repeated fashion the names of all good people, good years, and good events, and then take a bite of a meal. This pattern of eating was followed continuously, due to which the amount of time he would take for meals gradually increased from 10 minutes to around 45 to 50 minutes. On further questioning, he reports this was performed by him in his day-to-day tasks like brushing teeth, eating, bathing, and etc. On questioning, the child reports he was found to do these acts as it was giving him some relief in getting rid of distressing thoughts. The child had failed in class 7 exams, but he did not report about this issues to the family members. His mother shifted him to a different school in Hyderabad, where he was studying while staying at his maternal aunt's place. The child says he was ill-treated on multiple instances during his stay at Hyderabad. He says that the aunt made him slip on the floor and would give him food at midnight as punishment for any misbehavior. The child came back home in class 9. His mother says that it was during this time she noticed that he was frequently tapping on the table repeatedly. When she asked him what he was doing, he would not answer her and would ask her to repeat the names of people while eating or asking why or who these people are, he would not answer. This pattern was followed in odd numbers and in sometimes it was in an even number pattern. This behavior was present almost most of the times in a day. The child was found to be involved in tapping behavior whenever someone touches him. Along with this, he also would repeatedly go on a road and come on the same road over and over again. On questioning further, he reports if he does not do so, he fears something uneventful might happen to him and his mother. When he has to go out, he himself will not lock the door, and on counting and finishing the ritual, he will compel the mother to do so. If such behavior is causing distress in his daily living, ends up taking long time, around 50 to 60 minutes in accomplishing any given task. He has also discontinued the school since last 1 year and 5 months, and also led to multiple arguments with mother. Most of the time, it was a verbal abuse with the mother. Negative history. No history of repetitive hair pulling, skin picking, hoarding of unnecessary things. No history of trauma, fever, headache, vomiting, disorientation or memory disturbance. No history of substance abuse. No history of suspiciousness or hearing of voices in isolation. No history of irritability or talkative more than usual. No history of feeling low, loss of interest and suicidal ideation. No history of somatic complaints or preoccupation with the health. No history of eating and sleep disturbances. No history of delayed developmental milestone or difficulty in social communication or hyperactivity or inattention. So shall I continue?
Yes.
Past history. No history of psychiatric illness in the past. No history of medical illness like hypertension, diabetes mellitus, epilepsy, asthma, and thyroid dysfunction. No history of substance abuse. No history of fever or sore throat. Personal history. The child is the first born of a non-consanguineous marriage. The father's age was 37 years and mother's age was 30 years at the birth of the child. The child had a normal full-term vaginal delivery with no any prenatal complications reported in the mother and no any perinatal complications in the child. The developmental milestones were appropriate to age. Behavior during childhood was defined towards mothers, elders and teachers. The father of the child left home when the mother was carrying the child. But with mother as the sole parent having emotional disturbance, cursing her husband on multiple instances, mother used to hit him often in the name of disciplining him. The child gives history of being mocked by schoolmates and no any substance abuse reported. So shall I continue?
Yes.
The temperament of the child, activity level was age appropriate. The adaptability was difficult. He had difficulty adapting to the routine of a new classroom or a new situation. His approach withdrawal was appropriate to the new events. The patient was not having any distractibility and could sustain concentration. The quality of the mood, mother says he was predominantly found complaining or angry. With persistence and attention span being average. Family history. There is no history of psychiatric illness in the family members. Mother is BSc and BEd by education and a school teacher by profession. She is the breadwinner of the family. The child is close to the grandparents. The father, who was MCOM by education, is the third sibling of his parent. The father had two elder sisters and one younger sister. General examination. No pallor, icterus, clubbing, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy or edema. On central nervous system examination, the motor examination was within normal limits and cranial nerve examination was within normal limit. On cardiovascular system examination, S1 and S2 was heard with no any murmur on auscultation. On respiratory system examination, bilateral normal vesicular breath sounds were heard. Poor abdomen was soft, non-tender, and no any organomegaly was elicited. The pulse of the child was 78 beats per minute with regular good volume and no radial delay and no ectopics noted. With the blood pressure in sitting position was 110/70 mm of mercury. Sir, shall I continue?
Yes, ma'am.
On mental status examination, the child was wearing black t-shirt and gray jeans pant, was averagely built and moderately nourished, was maintaining eye-to-eye contact, was cooperative to the interview, and the rapport was built on multiple interviews. Child's speech, volume, tone, and tempo was normal, with average reaction time. Relevance to content was elicited, and prosody of the speech was maintained. With the thought sample on questioning which is his favorite festival, his answer was Dashara, the festival in which we celebrate by doing a puja of goddess Kanak Durga and offering the first harvest to the goddess, and would distribute food at the temple premises and would also meet friends and family and would share things. Mood. The quality of the mood was distressed with increased intensity, range restricted to sad, with reactivity present, no any diurnal variation observed, and appropriateness to situation was present with no any lability of mood. Thought, no any formal thought disorder was found, thought content was normal, with thought possession having obsession of miscellaneous origin and compulsion of mental compulsion and compulsive acts of counting, tapping and to and fro, counting compulsions. With stream, no any abnormality detected and no any illusions or hallucinations were present. On assessing the orientation, on asking the child the time, he responded it to be 5 p.m. The place, he answered it to be an hospital. And on person, he reported about the mother. So the inference is he's oriented to time, place and person. On attention and concentration, on doing the digit spine test, the child could do up to 6 digits. And in digit backward, the child could do up to 5 digits. On serial subtraction test, 100-7, the child could do serial subtraction up to 5 times. My inference is attention could be aroused and sustained for adequate period of time. On memory, on immediate memory, on conducting the digit span and digit forward, the inference was having intact immediate memory. With the recent memory, on asking the address test and recall of the last meal, the answer was dal, rice and curry. My inference would be intact. On eliciting the remote memory, the child could answer about his date of birth, the name of the school where he pursued his studies, and the time since the marriage of parents. These data were corroborated with the mother's finding, and so my inference is intact. On intelligence, the general fund of knowledge, the child could tell the correct response of the name of the Prime Minister, could name rivers, 5 cities of India and rivers of India. On comprehension, on asking him what he would do if it is cold, his response was he would switch off the fan and would use a bar. On arithmetic assessment, he could do division, multiplication, subtraction and addition up to 2 digits. On testing his abstract thinking, on giving him similarity test, on asking the similarity between a table and a chair, his answer was furniture. And on asking the similarity between eye and ear, his response was body parts. The test was conducted after giving him an example of what he's expected to respond. My inference is intact. In differences test, on asking him the differences between stone and a potato, his response was, it was a stone is a rock and potato is a vegetable. And on asking him the difference between cinema and radio, his response was, cinema we can see and radio is for listening. The inference is intact. On conducting the proverb test, the patient was asked a proverb in Telugu, Alasyam Amrutam Visham. His response was, delaying things will turn good into bad. And the second proverb which I asked him was, Dhurav Kondalu Nulupu. His response was, mountains and distant are smooth. So my inference is the patient is having an average intelligence. On testing his personal judgment, his answer was, on questioning about his future plans, his answer was to do job. So my inference is impaired personal judgment. On eliciting his test judgment, on giving him the problem of a fire and a letter problem, his response was, he fears that something bad might happen. And his social judgment, his behavior was found to be disrespectful in a situation where he's supposed to be calm. So the inference is he's having impaired personal test and social judgment. On eliciting his insight, he had grade 1 of insight on a grade of 1 to 6.
So, can we hold here for 10 minutes? I thank the presenter for taking an initiative, gathering the information and presenting it. So, and when it comes to history, like what else we would have focused and how else we would have organized it is one thing we can focus. So anyone, any of the participants have any thoughts regarding it? Like how, like what else would have been asked in HOPI and how else it would have been presented and what other possible diagnosis would have been kept in mind when the HOPI was presented. So any thoughts regarding how it would have been presented better? Second is, what else would have been explored? So any thoughts regarding these two things?
Sir, other symptoms of OC like repetitive checking and washing, I don't think that was mentioned. That also could have been mentioned in negative history.
Okay. In positive history, what else would have been quite useful in exploring?
Autism history.
So, there is one, we have some cognitive symptoms which are troubling the child. That is regarding OCD. I do take a point that in negative history, we would have added some more points. But in positive history, what else would have been asked? So, to answer one, there are two parts of story for this child's problem. One part is his troubled experience in the school and what didn't come up in much more clarity is like how and why this problem were happening. What was the content he was named as he was given a nickname. But why they were bullying him. How persistent it was. So this is, when it comes to bullying, it is a form of stress. So we need to explore the aspect of stress from how it was, how much severe it was, how much persistent it was, and what was the reaction to this stress from the child. This is one part of trauma that could have been in first part or second part based on the presenter's decision or discretion. Like one, you present the OC symptoms. He had magical thinking, ritualized behavior, fear of harm, and proxy compulsions. So this should come in themes, like once you narrate that which obsessive symptoms came fame. So it was it appeared to be like a magical thinking was initially started, and there were ritualized behaviors with obsessive slowness. Later, there was fear of harm, and proxy compulsion was also added into the picture. So this can be first part of HOPA, and we should move ahead and describe how much these problems were distressing to the child, how it was affecting his day-to-day functioning or academics. So this is one part. Second part is bullying and other stress experience. Like, for example, the bullying, who did, how often it was, how persistent it was, how troubling it was, how did it trouble his sleep or day-to-day activities, how did it trouble his mood, how did it trouble his day-to-day functioning. Because in this case, we have two aspects to it. There is a school refusal or a school absenteeism, and there are two issues to address. One is obsession or thought-related disorder. One is stress-related difficulty or disorder, you can say. So these two should be, we can elaborate in clarity. So when it comes to OCD per se, we would have asked tic disorder. And I want to ask the presenter this question, that in MSc you said he is sad. So, but in the HOPA you said he doesn't have any depressive symptoms. So in exam you may be contradicting yourself in this aspect. So what do you want to say about this?
One thing what came to my notice while taking the history of the patient was the child, out of his obsession, he was very much distressed, and in a way he was found in a state in which either he would be complaining or he would be not normally behaving, sir. So sir, when this is coming to our notice, can I say, sir, the mood to be sad, or I should say it like
We should not be in the term of diagnosis when we elicit symptoms. So he may be having anxiety, or he may be having sadness, and it can be secondary to the bullying experiences or the punishment experiences he had from his aunt, or it can be secondary to the OCD itself. So you can present that he has anxiety symptoms or sadness, which is not pervasive, but this is in the background of the difficulties or stress he faced, or in the context of OCD. So you may not need to diagnose that he has depression, but he definitely can have depressive symptoms which are not amounting to a diagnosis. So in HOPA, what things which we can make more clear is, like, there are two issues in this child: stress related, especially bullying and punishment. Second is obsessive thoughts, and they increase over time. So we need to track the timeline of bullying and punishment, what was his response, how it was affecting, and the OCD, so that we can delineate in our presentation itself, like, which part is playing what role in his current dysfunction, so that a listener can also understand, like, how OCD progressed in itself, how the stress persisted maybe for 2 years, how severe it was, and child tried to cope by not going to the school, change the syllabus, change in some other place. There also child was not able to cope. So there are two aspects to the HOPA. And in negative history, tic disorder is one, and fever, then other movement disorders, so then cognitive decline, those can also be added. This is regarding HOPA. So coming to personal history. So this in presentation, the focus was not adequately paid so to the academic part, like, especially because mother was there, she was a teacher, and he has been bullied in the school. Bullying happens because of the nature of the child, who are submissive, who are anxious, who are not very approachable to the others, or who can't share things. These are the people who are be targeting for the bullying. Are those who are dull, those who are below average in their academics, those people also will be targeted. So one thing I want to ask the presenter, that she will have an information to give information regarding his learning ability in the before joining to the school, in the early school, in the primary school, how was his academic abilities? So what was his relation with peers? Can a presenter throw some light on this part of personal history?
So, sir, his learning abilities, the mother reports the child never showed active interest of going to the school, and whenever the homework assignments were allotted, the mother reports it was very difficult for her to make him do the daily homework assignments. So one kind of disinterest towards the study was observed and reported, sir, from the mother.
So we should go beyond the disinterest in the child to explore why the child is not interested. Like, does he have learning related problem? The learning related problem can happen in two level. One is the learning capacity or overall intelligence is low or slow, so that he is a slow learner. Or it may be because there are difficulties in the language or mathematics, because of which he is avoiding. Third, he may have fine motor deficits, his handwriting is very poor, or he can have a combination of any of these three. So we can explore this. You have any information regarding these aspects?
Sir, learning disabilities, I had asked for, the child did not have any learning disabilities. And the mother reports that defiance was the main behavioral problem for which mother felt that he was not going to the school. He would be having
Right. Few questions to ask, like, how did you explore the academic performance or learning disorder? No issues. If you do mistakes also, don't worry about those part. It is a learning experience or learning exercise. How did you explore regarding academic abilities, or what approach a person can take when we approach to establish or explore regarding academic abilities for any child? Like, what approach you have taken? What were the questions you asked?
For this child, I started like, what was his first year when he was put in the preschool, and how good he was in grasping the number concept, the alphabets. Was he able to identify them? Was he able to write down when the works were when he was taught? Was he able to do it? And the spelling mistakes, if he had any, making mistake of D and P. Along with that, sir, I had asked whether whatever is being written on the blackboard, was the child able to copy while the class was going on, or he had to take help of the other schoolmates to finish the task which was taught to them in his classwork.
So, usual way in which we can explore is, we need to have a templates of questions in our mind to explore their learning capability or overall intelligence. And second is to explore about language or academic related specific difficulties. So learning difficulty can happen if the intelligence is low or if there is any learning disorder. So regarding intelligence, we can ask questions from the school, like, what was the feedback from the teacher, or in the house, based on the mother's observation. We have three concepts when we measure intelligence as per DSM-5: conceptual, problem solving, and social. Conceptual is understanding the concepts, not about academics, like, for example, money or gaming, any games, the rules of the games. So the game rules becomes complex as they grow old. So is he slow in those processes? Do the peer involve him or keep him away? This is one way of assessing overall intelligence. Second way is assessing his capability in social interaction. Does he know how to interact? Does he know how to converse in a shop? Does he know how to strike a conversation and get something from the shop? Is he capable to do that in the same level as others? This is the social domain. Problem solving is whenever there is a situation where he needs to think and solve some issues in the house related to day-to-day life. So can he apply them? So these are all the questions you can ask for the general intelligence. And many time parents say to us that he was little bit slow to learn. He take more time to learn. He's little bit slow compared to his peers. The same feedback we can get from the school teachers. So this is what we can focus on. This is regarding overall intelligence. So he's an average, above average, or below average. Was he was able to learn in the same speed, or he was slow to learn? Was he in the age appropriate norm, or he was below it? That is overall intelligence. Second is specific to academics. We have five parts in academics we explore. One is related to reading. Can he read? Second is related to reading, reading comprehension. Can he read through the subject, whatever is given? Many children will have additions, deletions, or mispronounce the things which they read. That is reading difficulty. Few children also will have difficulty in comprehending what they read. That is reading. In writing, there may be slowness in writing. There may be difficulty in writing. They may have confusion inside of the letters. They may have confusion in sounds of the letters. They may have spelling mistakes. Second is writing expression. They can follow the grammar rules. They can frame a sentence. They can frame a sentence and a long answer as required. So this is written expression. Spelling and written expression. Third is maths. With first standard, we will do addition, second standard subtraction, third standard multiplication, fourth standard division. So with each age, they will learn concepts from concrete level to semi-abstract to an abstract level. So we can ask this related to the academics. In this child, there is a school refusal. He was not successful as a person in academics also. Then he had bullying also. Then he has OCD also. So this information is needed for focusing or planning his rehabilitation. So you want him to study or not? Yes, we definitely want. Where he to study? What is his capacity? Because he need to be occupied in a day. For that purpose also we need information regarding the academics. Okay? Right. Okay. So when it comes to the part of MSc, you described the cognitive part well. It was very much deep. You also need to focus when you present about the phenomenology of the part of OCD itself. So that you need to separate the different phenomenon. Like in obsession, he has magical thinking. He has a compulsion, ritualized behavior. In obsession, he has fear of harm occurring to others. In about magical thinking, he also has proxy compulsions. So this all should be reflected, which you presented well in HOPA, should also get reflected in the MSc part, which makes things better. So now I request you to think, or all of us to think, and give, one or two persons can give differential diagnosis in this child, like what are all we can think of. So we can think in two lines. One is OCD and related disorder. One is stress and stress related disorder. Third, developmental related disorders. What are the possibilities? So with, I will ask the presenter itself to give the differentials and then go ahead with the formulation.
Sir, the differential diagnosis...
What you can think from HOPA.
Okay, sir.
You can give, whatever, don't mind. You can modify whatever you have written, no issues.
Sir,
one thing I will ask you, do you think the child may have some academic related problem? Is there a possibility or no? Clear. Whatever.
Sir, no possibility.
Okay, so we need to not make this conclusions when we present the case, because it needs very elaborate exploring, because a teacher of a mother, and she is not able to teach a child from early school days, is not we commonly see. And if the examiner or someone asks this question, then we may not be able to defend. So what I am trying to tell you is, when we give differential diagnosis, it is not that yes or no. It is possibility or not. We need to be more fine-tuned based on the facts we have and the need of exploration. In your state, I would have been there. I would have told, I think there is a need to explore, sir. And I consider it. And this can also contribute to a concern. That is one way in which I would have answered. So this is one. And exploration can lead to us some positives or some negatives. It doesn't matter. So now, when it comes to stress-related disorders, what are the differential diagnoses you want to consider?
One thing would be acute stress reaction, which the child might have
experienced. So, in the past, child would have had an acute stress reaction. Okay, agreed. What else?
To some extent, he was having this avoidance. So, sir, I would give a benefit of doubt, like whether the patient, whether the child was suffering from acute stress reaction, and then that it progressed to like PTSD.
So you can also think in line of PTSD. Yes. Very good. Yes. What else? So imagine this child, okay, where there is no father, mother is busy in the job, she is teaching him academics, she is not excelling in it, she is beating him, he goes to a school, no friends, no teacher is appreciating. How does it feel to child's mind? Happy, sad, what do you think?
Clear distress would be there in the child, sir.
Correct. So, there is less warmth because mother is distressed. There is no positive emotional experiences in the school, in teacher, in academics, or in peer circle. So, he has more distress and less warmth. That is quite evident. So, what other diagnosis you can consider? In stress-related disorder, you can think. So, we have adjustment disorder.
Yes,
correct?
Yes,
what are the subtypes of adjustment disorder?
Adjustment disorder with the specifier of depressed.
Okay.
Depressed feature, anxiety
right.
features, and Very mixed good. Feature.
What else? Depression. What else are the subtypes? So, there are subtypes called as mixed emotion and conduct. You have read? So, we don't use it. No. We don't usually use this.
Yes.
And this is below a year period or 6 months. It is not applicable to this child. But there is a diagnosis called as adjustment disorder with predominantly mixed emotion and conduct symptoms or predominantly other symptoms. Why they have made this? Because as the children, they can't be sophisticated and feel sad or to feel anxious or to have mixed anxiety and depression. They will express all these emotions by behaviors or conducts. So that is one subsection that is less applicable in this, but we need to have this possibility. What else? So in emotional disorder, we have something called as mixed disorder of emotion and conduct, where when they are in a stressful situation, they are having overwhelming emotions. They also will become angry, beat someone, or react to the parents. So that is mixed disorder of emotion and conduct. So we need to know the spectrum of stress disorders, and we should explore the possibility of which disorder this child may have. So, in the given information, I think I can consider this mixed disorder of emotion or emotional disorder which was not specified. There is a possibility in this child given the background. There is possibility of PTSD. There are a few symptoms which were suggestive. So, we can explore on it. So, this is regarding stress. Now, come to OCD. What else? In OCD, there are subtypes, no? There are mixed. There is predominantly aversion, there is rumination. So in children, our obsessions are different. Or how the OCD is different in children. And what are the diagnoses, what are the subtypes which are common, what you can consider. This also we can have a discussion. So we should think differential diagnosis when you see a child, because it is different from adult, where we don't consider learning disorder or developmental disorder as a factor. Second, the stress related disorder or bullying experience, punishment, it doesn't come in adult. When it comes to OCD, they will have more compulsions, less clear obsessions. They will have proxy compulsions more than the adults. So those are the other aspects to it. So this is the differential diagnosis which we can think from the HOPA. Okay. Now I request you to present the formulation and diagnosis and your treatment plan, and we can see how else we can refine it.
The diagnostic formulation: 15-year-old male, student of class 9, belonging to middle socioeconomic class, resident of Chirala, brought by mother, with obsessions and compulsion of miscellaneous origin and counting compulsion since 3 years. No prior treatment taken in adequate dose and duration, with personal history of normal full-term vaginal delivery with no any prenatal, perinatal and postnatal complication reported, with history of temper tantrums, defiance reported at home and school, discontinued school since last 1 year and 5 months from a single parent household. On general physical examination, the child was thin built. On mental status examination, the rapport was built on multiple interviews, with eye to eye contact maintained, with thought possession of obsession, magical thinking, and on compulsion, mental compulsions of tapping, counting, back and forth movement, counting compulsions. With bad prognostic factors of early age of onset and yielding compulsions, with absent insight, my provisional diagnosis is as per ICD-10, obsessive compulsive disorder, mixed obsessive thoughts and X, and as per DSM-5, it is obsessive compulsive disorder with absent insight.
So, as we discussed, we can consider the possibility of different diagnosis along with OCD as a comorbid disorder. So I would consider possibility of emotional disorder or a mixed disorder of emotional conduct, which will be secondary to the stress in which the child has been grown or child has faced. I will also like to explore the possibility of PTSD related symptoms. Second, in developmental disorders, what I need to keep is, I will tell, I need to explore regarding this learning and intelligence ability still more in clarity. So that is what I wish to take in the diagnosis. So we have a diagnostic access system in child psychiatry. So it may be not commonly known, and it is not expected if it has been not trained. How we go about is, axis 1 is a psychiatric disorder. Axis 2 is developmental disorder, specific disorder of scholastic skills, expressive speech delay. Those things will come in developmental disorder. Axis 3 is, does he have average intelligence or below average intelligence? Axis 4 is regarding any medical related health issues. Axis 5 is psychosocial factors, including family, school, bullying experience, then any distant community factors also, which are influencing the diagnosis. So these are the 5 axes. When a child case you can see, you can think of, it will help you to manage. So now we will go to the management part, and we'll try to wind up in 10 minutes. Now you focus. One is, you need to treat OCD. Second, you need to treat and heal him regarding bullying experiences. 3, you need to also focus on him doing something on day-to-day basis regarding whatever the education what he wants to attain. So based on this, can you present your management plan?
from the history which I have got and corroborated with the mother as the informant, I would like to admit the child for diagnostic evaluation and further management. After admitting, I would like to administer blood test of complete blood count and random blood sugar, and would also administer children's Yale-Brown obsessive compulsive scale questionnaire. Depending on the severity level, I will psychoeducate the patient and the family member about the OCD, that it's a biological disorder, and what is obsession, what is compulsion, and the anxiety and the distress with obsession compulsion, the OCD loop. I would like to explain to the patient and the family member. I would like to start him on fluoxetine 20 mg 100, and along with medication, I would start sir non-pharmacological management in the form of cognitive behavior therapy, in which sir first of all I would work on cognitive drilling and the behavior therapy of exposure and response prevention.
What else?
In exposure and response prevention, I would ask the patient about the symptom list, the hierarchy of symptoms which is making him distress, and I would start from the obsessions and compulsions which are least distressing to the topmost level.
So your diagnosis, your investigations are focusing on OCD. What else?
Okay, sir. Along with this, the patient is having academic issues. So I would like to focus or explore about whether the child is having any learning disability or whether the child is having some stress reaction. So depending on the line, and I would like to work on the behavioral problems like defiance, temper tantrums, what all is it? So that I would like to explore more, sir.
What else?
And, sir, in this, with mother as the sole parent, I would like to psychoeducate the mother, and her emotional ventilation also I would like to take into consideration.
How a child is different from an adult? Child is different from an adult because there is a academic focus which he needs to have. There is a peer experiences which he needs to have. So it is not our intervention. Yes, it is good in compared when it comes to OCD. But we should also focus something about how we can work through, how we can focus on school resuming, or how we can go about that process. So if I want to discuss, I will tell why you need to admit this case. How you will defend?
Sir, the reason for admitting the patient, I felt the need so. Like the patient had early age of onset of OCD, and there has no any intervention being done. They have not consulted any doctor till now. So, and school refusal is there, sir.
So why you need to admit? What you can do which you can't do in OP basis? I'm being a devil advocate. I do respect the decisions you have made, but I'm asking as a discussion.
Sir, the non-pharmacological management, it would be very aggressive. Once a patient is getting admission, we can observe his eating pattern, which is in a very ritualistic fashion. We can make him understand about the rationale of ERP, sir. So, sir, exposure and response prevention will give good results once the patient is in a controlled environment, and then gradually the patient is exposed to the real world.
Okay. So, why you can't do this in OPD basis after calling him repeatedly? So, we can take an answer that preferably, I will give an option for IPK. If they are not willing, I can manage the case, or I will try to manage the case in outpatient. It is not mandatory. There is no risk to self. There is no risk to others. Or there is no severe aggression, violence. There is no threat to safety. So we can be more, diplomatic or practical, that I prefer to admit for so and so reasons. Yes, the reasons you said that he needs, we need to observe his OCD symptoms, symptomatology, yes. What else I would have told in this position is that child has multiple issues. He was not successful in studies. He had bullying. He had OCD. And with 40 minutes, I can't understand a child life for 6 years. So I need to understand different aspects of it, to explore different aspects of it, and to come with a plan which can be useful for the three aspects. So I will consider admission, which will fasten the process than which is there in a outpatient basis, so that I can start the management plan early. I do agree. So now, what are the assessments? So you have a short-term plan and you have a long-term plan. What are the short-term targets you have?
Sir, currently the presentation was with OCD. There is a lot of distress because of his compulsions to the mother.
So you have a obsessive compulsive symptoms as a targets with you. One. What else? Yes,
sir. And sir, once OC symptoms are under control, I would focus on the school refusal and the academic decline. What is it? And
so second target is focusing in his academics and school resuming. Yes. What else are the targets?
So the third, I would talk about the mother if she is in need of any kind of emotional venting out, or what are the instances in which
okay. What else? With child, what else are the targets? School, OC symptoms. What else? So child has undergone quite an amount of trauma. So addressing this trauma and doing the trauma related work should be another target. Right?
Yes.
Yes. So someone has put it in the chat. What else? So one, exploration phase, developmental disorder, emotional disorder, OCD. So targets, OCD symptoms, impact of trauma on emotions and behaviors, then school resuming, and inputs for academic difficulty it was found. Okay, but we can't do it all, everything in a go. But addressing the emotional concerns, giving a child a impression if he has academic difficulty that is your not fault, it will have a huge impact on his treatment agreement or motivation to respond to your therapy. So this is regarding the targets. So first target, OC symptoms, how we will address. So one is medication. What medication you will give? What dose? For what duration?
Sir, for medication, I will start with fluoxetine 20 mg, sir. And depending on his on the response, I would uptitrate up to 60 mg, sir.
Okay. Along with, so now we need to specify the target severity.
Yes.
Like we need to put the assessment scales for OCD, for trauma-related difficulties, depression, anxiety. And once you have set the severity, you will give a trial. And if the illness is quite severe, you need not to wait for the response. Response comes after 6 weeks or 3 months. You need to give a full dose trial for the OCD medication over. Then coming to therapy for OCD, how different it is from adult. So in children, they will have less insight or less capability to work through the obsessions. So they have a modified approach, which are age appropriate. Like you can refer a book by name Dr. John Marsh. He is the authority in pediatric OCD. He will give you how to assess the symptom checklist, how to assess the severity, then how to go about CBT involving ERP. Yes. What you will do is to trauma-related concerns. Does the child have any positive experiences? In life, what has child enjoyed? That is the question I have. So, child has less experience of relaxation, less experience of positive emotions. So, I will focus on behavioral activation and relaxation for trauma-related aspect. That is first. Second, then reappraise the difficulties he has faced. Reappraise. So reappraise the difficulties and not to blame himself and make some thoughts clear that it was all friend's mistake. He is not one to blame or he is not so bad. So this is to validate and allow him to ventilate. then to rework through the trauma. Next is to build a plan, what he wants to do and how he wants to do. So this is related to trauma work. So you do it, this trauma related work and OCD related work, you will do for maybe 4 weeks or 6 weeks in inpatient or 2 months in outpatient. How and what way you want to make him to resume school? If you are not successful, what you will do is a question.
Sir, on long term, first of all, I'll give him a trial of pharmacology. Like if the first SSRI, like fluoxetine, if the patient is not showing the desirable and expected response, I will give him a trial of other selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, like sertralin, fluoxamine.
How you will plan is resuming school. That is what the question. How you will plan the school resuming part of the target? Will you keep it as a short term or a long term target? Then if it is a medium term target, how we will do it? Will you send the school from day one? Will you gradually send him to school? If you fail to send him to school, what else you will do?
Okay, sir. While resuming his school, I will start him, making him understand like what are the reasons, so that if there is a guilt or if there is a blaming part responsible for him, that I will work on it. And then I will keep it in the acute term. My first focus would be to relieve the OC symptoms. And then in the medium term, I would focus on the school resuming, in which I will ask the child to go on a gradual basis. Like initially, he can go like 1 to 2 hours and then for a whole day, and then like 5 days a week, and then like the whole week, and then a whole month.
Very good. So gradually you want to make him to resume school. Okay.
Yes,
so if you fail in this, what you will do?
Sir, rehabilitation can be catered to the family, sir.
How? What is that rehabilitation means to you? Like how you will do it?
Sir, in the child, I will rehabilitate in the form, like, first of all, sir, I will make him understand what is OCD and what all has happened up till now. So
okay.
Once that distress from the child in himself is cleared out, I feel that the child can definitely have good academics.
Okay. So if he doesn't go, what he will do? That is what I am asking.
When you are in exam,
that is how they will ask. If you are not successful, what you will do? You will tell to parents that I am failed, I will not do anything, or what else you will do?
Some kind of reinforcements has to be discussed.
I am telling you are failed. You are not able to send him to school. What you will do? So, basically, my response would have been, if it in your position, is I will make him understand after the assessment what all the difficulties he has faced in the school, how the protection will be given to prevent them. I will ensure to take the child in the confidence, how the support will be given by the teachers. Third, I will make or allow him to make the decisions that when he wants to resume the school. If I am not successful in doing these aspects in 6 weeks or 8 weeks, then I will not push the tail too much, but I will start exploring other options regarding academics where he can do some work or study related activities in the house itself, where he will study for 2 hours in the morning or 2 hours in the evening. He can opt a regular option of a school by having a dialogue with them and getting a permission, and I will give a letter so that they can get the help, or I will give the option of NIOS, that is National Institute of Open Schooling, where some other teacher can come and teach for 2-3 hours per day to the house, so that his education part is taken care of. Second, we need to give him some positive experience, especially in a day he should be busy doing something which will give some relaxation to him, which will give some responsibility to him. Because as he grows, we don't know what happens to OCD. But he should be able to care for himself, do some household work, and know something which is related to academics. So we need to be ready that if there is a difficulty in one, we will do the alternate. So that is how we can approach. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So trauma related work also is very much needed, because he is less assertive, he is not bold enough, he can't take a problem solving approach in a social situations. So do you think if he is not prepared for all this, or the support is not adequately enough made in the school, can he resume it? So we need to prepare a child, and we need to allow the child to make a transition, and we need to do it in his comfort by enhancing the adequate support. And if we fail, we should have an alternate option. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Hopefully it was useful. So yes, any last queries you can ask. So it was good, and it was because you see more adult cases and you present them, that child related perspective aspect is not expected out of you. But if you can enhance these aspects in your presentation, in your exploration, and in your management, it is not only to the exam, you can also can provide a better evaluation and care for child clientele after your degree also.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any questions, any feedback, let us know. And we are open. If there is anything which we can improve, we'll be happy to do that. I thank the presenter again. So it was a nice work which was put up, and definitely it was quite a learning experience for me.
We also thank Dr. Rajendra for taking up this topic today. Any last minute comments, Dr. Rajendra?
No, thank you. It was nice. And when it comes to child, we need to have some prism, what is developmental perspective. That developmental perspective is what we need to practice and learn, so that it will help us to understand, to interact, and to intervene. Thank you all.
I think it was a... thank you, Dr. Rajendra. I think it was a good presentation. All in all, if... anybody who is not from this background, from child psychiatry background, if they had taken, we would have probably done in the same way which Dr. Nima has done. So it is good to have a perspective of certain issues which are very important when we are taking child and adolescent psychiatry case, which was brought forth by Dr. Rajendra here. What we should also remember, some of the other points which we should remember when there is a person with OCD in child, which we did not discuss in elaboration here, is something called as PANDAS. So, and treatment of PANDAS also would be important in a case of OCD. The other thing what we should also remember is that when we start fluoxetine, any SSRI comes with a black box warning. In child and adolescents, it is known that any SSRIs would cause about twofold increase in suicidal ideations. So there is a black box warning on all SSRIs, which also should be kept in mind when starting on fluoxetine.
Yeah. So last point, as I briefly mentioned, in the negative static disorder, they can also ask for Tourette's disorder and PANDAS. So I do completely copy what Chetan has said regarding the presentation, and it was a good effort and it was very well done. Thank you.
Thank you, Anand. We would be ending the meeting now. Thank you.